So, what are solid principles? First of all, what is the meaning of the word principle? Principle means a solid foundation underlying some system. For example, there are certain principles of life which says that you should be humble with others, you should work hard. Now, if you look at it, whenever you take some action in your life, those actions could have these underlying principles. But in reality, all those principles might not underlie a particular action. For example, an action where you had to be firm with somebody does not involve you being kind as a principle, right? But that is actually a good action. Similarly, what I'm trying to say is that there are design principles which are like foundations behind low-level design of systems, but it can very well happen that you came up with an LLD which does not honor all those principles. It kind of honors only few of those. So that is to be kept in mind before we embark about learning solid principles in general. If you were to ask me that, hey, just quickly explain me that what does SOLID, each of them mean? It's very simple. S stands for single responsibility principle, which simply says that a class should have one and only one reason to change. For example, let us say there is a class and it has got three different methods inside it. The first method is read from socket, which reads some data from some socket. And then the second method is crunch data. It crunches the data that it has read. And the third method is write to DB. If you look at this class, it is composed of three methods, but now this class has a humongous amount of reasons to change. So tomorrow, if the logic to write to the database has to be optimized, then you have to touch this class. Similarly, if the logic for crunching the data, analyzing it has to be changed, again, you have to touch this class. So there are multiple touch points for this class. And now if you talk about how the unit test for this class will look like, then that will be huge. And if that test suite fails, you'll be scratching your head thinking that, hey, which functionality could have gone wrong, because our class is composed of multiple functionalities. So a class which is bereft of single responsibility principle is a real pain to test. And it undergoes frequent changes, and frequent changes are a gateway to bugs, as we all know from our experience. O stands for open-closed principle, which says that the piece of code that you write, the class that you write, it should be open for extension and closed for modification. Now, there is a very fine line in between extension and modification. Let me give you a quick example. Let's say you have started working for an e-commerce company and you have just built your payment gateway, which for now accepts payments via cards. But you have built it in a manner that tomorrow, if you want to start supporting UPI payments, then integrating that is a piece of cake for you. It is not going to require you to change loads of classes. It might even be just few lines of code change, or maybe introduction of few classes only. But on the other hand, if you wrote your code in a way that introducing a new thing, a new mode of payment, required you to change tons of classes, then that I would say was a poorly designed code base. Okay, I was also talking about the difference between extension and modification actually. You can always design a good system by thinking about extension. This is an extension. Today you are supporting payment through one mode. Now tomorrow you should be able to support via other modes as well. Modification is something which is very, very different. Modification could be something like this, that okay, today I have an e-commerce. What if tomorrow I add a new branch to it, or I pivot my business to stock trading? Will I be able to switch my code base pretty quickly? If you think like this while doing your low-level design, you will never be able to do that. Modification is not your responsibility. That modification usually happens when pivots happen, when extremely unknown features are added. Extensions happen because they are foreseen. So that is the idea behind open-closed principle. And if you have to abide by open-closed principle, you have to learn about the idea of polymorphism in depth. The third one is L, which stands for Liskov substitution principle. Okay, don't go by the name. Let me give you a very simple example. Sometimes what happens is people make terrible use of inheritance. terrible use. See, inheritance should ideally be used only if there is a strict parent-child relationship. And what I mean by parent-child relationship is everything that parent has that makes sense for a child. For example, let's say today you are running an e-commerce company for delivering the medicines. So your product was medicine. So you just wrote a class called as product, which has method get ID, get name, get expiry date, and so on and on and on, right? Now tomorrow you started selling books also. So now you quickly ended up writing a class called as book, and you made that as a child class of your product because you ended up realizing that, hey, every book will also have an ID and name. But here you go wrong. Books will not have an expiry date. And because of that reason, you might want to override that method to throw some sort of exception that, hey, this method is not supported on book. Now, this thing is bad. So basically, Liskov substitution principle says that the derived types should be substitutable by base types. Here, your derived type is a book, and this does not support or offer functionalities that are mentioned in the parent. The third one is interface segregation principle. Simple example. Let's say there is an interface called as shape. It has methods like get area, get volume. And now you wrote a class called as cube and you implemented the functionalities. And then somebody else wrote a class called as circle and made it implement the same interface. Now that guy will be confused what to do when volume is to be returned, because 2D shapes are not going to have any volume, right? So a way to solve this problem could be that, hey, instead of having one bulky interface, let's have multiple interfaces. So let's have an interface called as 2D shape. Let's have another interface called as 3D shape. Both these interfaces have method get area, but only the 3D shape has a method get volume, right? So if I were to tell you, the most ideal kind of interface is that which only has one small method inside it. At times you can have 2 to 3 methods, but you know, idealism cannot be always achieved in practical life, right? But the learning to take from here is that try to keep your interfaces as slim as possible, because if you make them bulky, the problem that we just took a look at might happen. The final principle is D, which is dependency inversion. It says a very simple thing. It says that if you have a class, try to make it depend on abstractions rather than concretions. If your class is dependent on a concrete entity, that means it is not flexible. It cannot support similar concrete entities in the future. But on the other hand, if it is dependent on an abstract class or an interface which can be implemented by different concrete entities, then your class is much more flexible. It is much more extensible. So these were the solid principles for you. Honestly speaking, you need to pierce through what their real meaning is, and you need to apply them in the code that you write. Then only you will see the value in them.